Welcome to part 2 of Campi Flegrei, the second Phlegraeaen eruptions. In part 1 of this 4-part series, we covered the cataclysmic destruction unleashed by Campi Flegrei's first supervolcanic size eruption that might have just been the final stressor that plunged the already declining European Neanderthals into extinction, with them vanishing from the fossil record around the time of this unimaginable eruption, which was unleashed upon the entirety of Europe and then the world after this 2 to 4 day long single eruption occurred between the years of 37 and 39,000 BC. In this episode, we're going to learn the facts of the second Phlegraeaen eruption, so let's get started. After the cataclysm unleashed upon the Earth between the years of 37 and 39,000 BC, Campi Flegrei wasted no time in rebuilding its massive interconnected magma chambers to release another Earth-shattering eruption upon Europe. Only 2,000 years would pass before it would make its reappearance upon the surface, in a time period so short, it's almost unheard of for mega-eruption-sized volcanoes, all of which normally take tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands of years to recharge their gigantic magma chambers. Campi Flegrei, however, is a rare beast that is incredibly skilled in the art of destruction. Between the vast time periods ranging from 35,000 to 10,500 years ago, the Phlegraeaen fields, time and time again, would resemble a hellfire, erupting in a huge manner, though luckily these eruptions were all at a smaller scale than the previous single super eruption we covered in part 1. All of these, however, dwarfed the normal eruptions we are used to from your typical stratovolcano, and was still in the range of a volcanic explosivity index of 7, ranging from an eruption that was at the minimum either equivalent in scale to Mount Tambora or just slightly under it, and at a maximum just under the mega eruption during the first Phlegraeaen period. The majority of these eruptions are still visible today in the many calderas observable around Naples in Italy, which becomes especially obvious when looking at it through satellite imagery. However, Campi Flegrei is deceiving in many ways. 15,000 years ago, Campi Flegrei changed its strategy, which culminated in the most devastating eruption within the time period of the second Phlegraeaen period. In the past few thousand years, it worked at extending its magma chamber by widening its width, which led to it striking in a seemingly more innocuous and silent place, seemingly being the key word, until it decided to blow. This time period within the second Phlegraeaen period is referred to as the Neapolitan Yellow Tuff eruptions. Yellow tuff is a soft rock of volcanic ash that was a very popular item for construction since ancient times. It's amazing to think the yellow tuff of this eruption was used in the construction of the Roman Empire, and in a moment you'll see why. Just off the coast of the present-day town of Pozzuoli, this volcano decided to give the animals and humans alive that inhabited the area a new surprise, in the form of a new disaster to deal with alongside its gigantic eruptions, mega tsunamis. You see, volcanic eruptions are generally less impactful in regards to tsunami generation compared to, say, a very large earthquake. But this rule only applies if it occurs in very deep water, such as what is found in the Pacific Ocean, and is why there aren't many noteworthy tsunamis of volcanic origin from there that occurred directly because of the eruption. Landslides and other means of displacing water during a volcanic eruption are a disaster in itself, but in this situation I'm referring solely to the magnitude of the eruption causing the displacement of water and only that, with a comparison to something like a bomb being detonated underwater. The reason tsunamis of volcanic origin aren't powerful if they are generated in deep water is because the dispersal is so huge that it can't concentrate on one area, and the energy from the eruption gets scattered immensely, producing short period waves. However, eruptions that occur in shallow areas are a completely different scenario. The differing length to depth ratio of the waves rapidly increase, and the run up inland can be unimaginably high, which leaves the closest bit of land to the eruption in this situation vulnerable to suffering from gigantic waves that could reach a height over 50 to 100 meters or more, depending on where it erupts and the intensity of the eruption. There have been many noteworthy tsunamis that were generated directly from volcanic eruptions in history, but a more recent illustration of this was the Kerensky Lake eruption in Russia, which in a relatively small lake of just over 2 kilometers, a 19 meter high tsunami was produced as a result of the volcano erupting. With a normal volcano, a mega tsunami is not likely to occur. However, with a supervolcano, it definitely can if it is located in shallow enough water. The Neapolitan Yellow Tuff eruption occurred in the shallow bay off the coast of Pozzuoli, and to this day is the largest known aquatic eruption ever studied. When magma reacts with water, the type of eruption produced differs from the more typical eruption most people have in mind when they think of volcanoes. By that, I mean the ones that occur with overpressurization due to an accumulation of gases that are released when surrounding rock in the magma chamber is melted, which, in the process of this, releases volatile gases that are directly responsible for the increases in pressure within the chamber. Rock is melted into magma, it releases explosive gases, pressure as a result of this rises within the chamber, and this pattern steadily repeats until it reaches a critical level where it finally triggers a release through eruption. There are a few different types of volcanic eruptions, but I'm only going to mention the two that relate to this scenario. Normally, what comes to mind in the aforementioned circumstances is a type of eruption which is named a Plinian eruption. These are the large volcanoes such as the one that devastated Pompeii or the eruption of Mount St. Helens in America. The underwater eruption of Campi Flegrei occurred as a result of new magma reacted to being exposed to seawater rapidly, which is a type of eruption referred to as phreatomagmatic eruptions, in which both magmatic gases and steam from water are expelled. Now, I've got to quickly get into a little of the science of this to allow you to appreciate and imagine the scale of just how giant and devastating this eruption would have been, and how a tsunami could be created from it, as well as how a wave generated as a result of this would have been a towering mega tsunami. Is so high it is truly terrifying to imagine. The exact nature of how volcanoes erupt from a phreatomagmatic eruption is still a cause of debate that has been narrowed down to two possible situations, or a combination of the two. They are either driven by thermal contraction, which is the complete opposite to the volcanic eruptions, such as the one I described during a Plinian eruption, which are driven by thermal expansion. Thermal expansion occurs when you heat a material and it gains more internal energy, such as a supervolcano heating and then melting more and more rock, adding to its thick gelatinous chamber of magma, which builds more pressure and explosive energy in the form of the gases released from melting the rock that allows the chamber to gain more internal energy. The atoms within the materials move around faster and the material expands, or in this case, the magma chamber expands, and that's why we see a swelling of the ground before supervolcanoes erupt, which we have seen in the case of Campi Flegrei in recent times, but I'll cover that more in part 4. Until, like a balloon, the supervolcano reaches a critical level, overpressurizes, and explodes, causing an eruption triggered by the thermal expansion. Thermal contraction occurs when you cool the material down and the atoms don't have that much energy. So to apply this onto the scenario being described, it basically means the magma suddenly changes shape, area, and volume in response to a change in temperature, such as water contacting magma in a very sudden manner. The massive temperature difference between the magma and the cool water causes very violent interactions that make up the eruption. You can see this for yourself if you heat up a pan and then put cold water onto the pan once it's very hot. This tiny little explosion is basically a replica of what would have happened during this situation. The second way that is debated is called fuel coolant reactions, which are speculated to be more critical to the incredibly explosive nature rather than just solely thermal contraction. However, it could also be from both of these combined rather than from only one or the other. A fuel coolant reaction is just basically a steam explosion, which is an explosion created by the immediate and violent boiling of water into steam when it is superheated rapidly, which seems to explain why these types of eruptions are so violent. Personally, I think it's a combination of both of these that make large-scale aquatic or groundwater-based eruptions so violent. Okay, that's the science out of the way. Now, let's get into the fun stuff. A supervolcano and a 100 meter high wave, which is 328 feet with a lip of 191 meters or 640 feet. A lip is the expression used to explain the top of the wave that curls forward. If this was the scenario, it would have been so terrifying it'll make your skin crawl before it crushes you with the incredible weight that is equivalent to 2,183 brown elephants that weigh 6 tons each, or 874 Tyrannosaurus rexes that weigh 15 tons each. This wave has a total weight of 13,120 tons. Ouch. This is just a quick example of how heavy the wave would have been if it was this big. The reality is it could have been way bigger or a little bit smaller, but either way it was still gigantic. This eruption, due to it being underwater, has very conservative estimates being attributed to it. Some scientists suggest it was larger than 100 cubic kilometers in size, which is proving to be true more and more every day as more studies are conducted on it. Conservative estimates place the number, at the very least, within the range of 40 cubic kilometers of volcanic debris released that covered an area of at least 1,000 kilometers squared around its epicenter. The problem with attempting to study an ancient underwater supervolcanic eruption, aside from the obvious inaccessibility and inability to study like you normally would on land, is also the fact that the ocean, far more than the land, is in constant flux, washing debris into the deeper recesses or pushing it on land before sucking it back in and sending it to some faraway place for it to finally come to a rest. There are, however, some facts that are well established. This is most definitely the largest phreatomagmatic eruption ever known to man. It also generated the second largest pyroclastic deposit ever known, only coming second to the first super eruption covered in our last episode. The pyroclastic flows occurred underwater, which is both incredible and baffling to attempt to imagine, and the resulting sediment raised the seafloor where it erupted, making it even more shallow than it previously was. When this volcano blew, fallout was ejected up to 34 kilometers from the vent, which is incredible when you understand this happened underwater. The scale of explosivity for this distance to have been reached would have been enormous. This is where things get dangerous, however, in a similar, albeit lesser effective fashion to tsunamis induced by earthquakes. During the eruption, just like the previous one, the magma chamber collapsed upon itself as it was emptying. So this is a two-pronged effect. An earthquake generates a tsunami due to the sudden displacement of a large quantity of water, such as when a tectonic plate slips downwards against the plate it is pressing against, which causes a massive amount of water to also slip down with it, only to rebound back up, producing a deadly tsunami in the process. This gigantic underwater supervolcano collapsed upon itself during its massive eruption. This not only displaced the water by a large area of land suddenly collapsing upon itself, but also by the gigantic eruption that led to the chamber emptying to the point of collapse. So in this situation, there are two catalysts that produce a series of tsunamis, not just one. And to top it off, it's in shallow water. This is more than enough reason for the generation of a mega tsunami. So, off the coast of Pozzuoli, a massive eruption occurs underwater. Within a few minutes, Pozzuoli, Naples, Sorrento, and the three neighboring islands are consumed by a gigantic wave that swept inland for kilometers. When it finally recedes and when the eruption is finally over, what is left aside from the complete sterilization of all life on the surrounding lands is a ridiculous amount of yellow tuff, just waiting to be mined and used by the Romans and Neolithic humans thousands of years later. And that was the last major eruption of the Second Phlegraean Period. It ushered in the Third Phlegraean Period. This final eruption was responsible for the formation of the caldera that encompasses the modern-day town of Pozzuoli, which sits inside the caldera, and it transpired during the time when the Younger Dryas Ice Age event suddenly descended upon the Earth, which before it was heating up. The cause of this is unknown and is still being researched to this day to find out what sequence of events caused this ice age. A recent gigantic meteorite crater in Greenland was found underneath the ice sheets, which may have coincided with this period. But the finding is very recent and needs to be studied further for an accurate idea of the situations that led up to its formation, as well as what was produced after it and when it was produced. The reason I am mentioning this is because one scary thought I've had is that if it did strike the Earth around this time, the shockwaves produced would have been enormous and might have actually caused Campi Flegrei to erupt. Just like we covered in our video on the North Korean supervolcano and what happened to the magma chamber when Kim Jong-un detonated nuclear bombs near it, which sent powerful pressure waves towards Paektu Mountain and the giant magma chamber contained within it, with that pressure then being transferred to the magma inside. If this meteorite struck and the pressure from it caused this supervolcano to erupt, that would have been a truly grim time to have been alive. So that concludes part 2 of our 4-part series on Campi Flegrei. I want to thank all of you for watching. I hope you found this interesting and learned a few things. In part 3, we are going to cover the third and final Phlegraean period before concluding our series in part 4, where we will be covering Campi Flegrei in modern day, which many speculate will be the next supervolcano to erupt on Earth due to the fact it has been steadily increasing in activity in the past few decades and the ground has shown some signs of swelling. We will also cover the situation of what would happen if it erupted in a scale similar to the mega eruption witnessed in the first Phlegraean period. Thank you again for watching and supporting my channel. I'll see you all in part 3.